Murder Afloat by L. Ron Hubbard.
This is Captain Simmons, Clark. I've uncovered the information you want. Come up immediately.
As Bob Clark, ace operative of the Narcotics Squad, U.S. Secret Service, listened, his long fingers tightened about the cabin phone receiver. He had received his summons to death.
Yes, sir.
The SS Cubana rolled gently in the dark swell. An orchestra played in the salon while cocktail glasses clinked at the bar. In front of Bob Clark's porthole, a man in trim evening clothes had stopped. The flare of the match held to a cigarette illuminated a face as sharp as a blade, eyes as black as the night. Clark was not thinking of the face, but he remembered it. Gently, he replaced the receiver and got up. He took a .38 and a handful of shells. Drawing his gray felt hat down over his right eye, he stepped out on deck and strode forward, every nerve alert. He had been expecting this, but the manner of its coming had been strange. In spite of the gaiety aboard the Cubana, he knew that death stalked. The voice, smooth, oily, had not been that of Captain Simmons. Only one man aboard this ship had known that Clark was a Secret Service operator on the trail of $1.5 million worth of dope. That man was the captain. Tonight, the captain had promised to give Clark the information as to the identity of the shipper. Clark ascended to the bridge. The captain's cabin lay but a few feet down the dark passage ahead. Clark stiffened. Somewhere in that passage, above the roar of wind and engines, he had heard the snick of a gun hammer being cocked. He eased into the shadow and peered ahead. This, then, was the trap. A crude, cold-blooded attempt to murder him. From the rack above his head, Clark took down two life preservers of the jacket type. Stringing them together, he made a panel about 2 feet wide and 5 feet long. Suddenly, he thrust it out into the passage. The preserver jerked. A slug whined off steel and out to sea. The passage flared with a sudden light, but the sound of the gun was merely a cough, the muffled sound of a silencer. Clark dropped the preservers and stepped back. In an instant, the would-be murderer would come up to investigate, and then Clark drew his .38 and balanced himself against the roll of the ship. Footsteps were coming toward him, cautious, slow. A black form stopped over the life preservers. Clark lunged. He jabbed the muzzle of the gun into yielding ribs. Then the revolver was slapped to one side. A fist caught Clark under the ear. He realized that he was fighting a man of tremendous strength. Clark's antagonist was a shimmering haze before his face. The ship rolled, making footing uncertain. Clark's opponent seemed everywhere at once. The federal man's hands clutched at the padded shoulders of the black overcoat. Something gave way. Abruptly, Clark lurched backward, striving to keep his feet. The empty overcoat was in his hands. The passage was deserted.
Gone.
Clark snorted in disgust and strode on down to the captain's cabin. An odor, acrid and disagreeable, was in the air. Burning flesh. Clark kicked in the door and fumbled for the light switch along the wall and shot it on. Captain Simmons lay on the floor, his face twisted, gray with agony. The master of the Cubana was dead. Clark jabbed his glance about the room. He sidestepped until his back was no longer toward the door. Then he turned to the body. Simmons' shoes had been removed. A pile of matches lay beside the rumpled rug. The soles of the captain's feet were black and charred. Clark understood then how the information about his presence aboard the Cubana had been obtained.
The inhuman fiend. He tortured it out of poor Simmons.
A pack of playing cards had been spilled off the desk in the struggle. Clark noted that one of the cards was lying near Simmons' hand. It was turned face up, and it was the Ace of Spades. He saw then that Simmons' fingers were tightly wrapped about a pencil. Evidently, he had died slowly, horribly, but he had forced himself to try to write out a clue to the crime. Clark inspected the card under the light. On its surface, so faint as to be almost indiscernible, were several scrawled letters.
Madame Sève.
After that, the pencil had slid off the card. Bob Clark did not need the last of the name.
Madame Seville. That's the information he had for me.
That name was the key to $1.5 million worth of dope which was reported to be aboard the Cubana at the time of her sailing from Havana. Madame Seville was a notorious woman ally of the greatest dope smuggler in the West Indies. With the ring identified, Clark expected little difficulty in rounding up its members aboard the ship. He would go to the first officer immediately and inform him that the captain was dead. Then, with the help of others, he would ferret out each and every suspected man on the Cubana. The time had finally come to crush this wholesale importation of heroin and opium. The Cubana was taking her last load north. He noted the time on his wristwatch. Something made him jerk his head up to the ship's clock above the captain's desk. The hour was 8, but something was wrong about the clock. He frowned and stared at his polished metal face. Then he knew it had not struck 8 bells.
That's funny.
But Clark's hand never reached the dial. He heard the creak of hinges and whirled. Gun in hand, he leaped toward the panel, but he was too late. The door was slammed and locked before he could reach it. Clark whirled to the porthole. It was closed with a metal cover. Nevertheless, he darted out his hand and shut off the light. The Cubana was lunging on through the sea without a captain, and Bob Clark, ace operative of the narcotics squad, was a captive on the bridge. Cautiously, Bob Clark removed the disc from the porthole and stared forward toward the bow. 5 men were there, all well-dressed, 3 of them in evening clothes. They were not talking, just staring ahead into the black night, turning occasionally to glance aft, an unmistakable attitude of waiting about them. One of them was the same face he had seen outside his port during the call from the bridge. But why were these passengers here? Were they afraid something might happen to the ship? One of the men, Chunky, Clark knew. He was Harrington, head of a sugar central in Cuba. Another, Clark thought he identified as Morcliffe, manager of an oil company. Perplexed, the federal man gave his attention to the problem of escape. All bells and buttons in the room had been disconnected. Then a faint hissing sound reached his ear. As Clark listened, the sound increased. He tried another porthole, but it was too small to permit him to pass through it. Twice he tried shouting through the porthole, but there was no response. Then a scent reached him. It was acrid, biting. He went to the door and sniffed vigorously. Smoke. The Cubana was on fire at sea. Thin blue coil of smoke eddied through the top of the doorway. No alarm gongs were going. No feet pounded in panic across the decks. There were no sounds of boat falls, and yet the thin column of smoke curled and thickened the air in the cabin.
What's the matter with them? All asleep?
Clark demanded of the empty cabin. The trickery of the wind wafted a chord of music to the bridge. The orchestra was still playing. They were still dancing in the salon. Clark hammered on the pane again. Still, there was no answer. The Cubana had begun to swing off course. That meant that no hand guided the helm. The smoke was becoming thicker, but as Clark made his way around the walls for the 100th time, he found one corner where it was not quite so bad. He searched until he found a grating against the ceiling. This was a ventilator leading up to the boat deck, a 2-foot tube through which a man might conceivably crawl. Clark dragged the grating toward him. Pulling himself up, he drew his shoulders through the opening. It was a tight squeeze. Again, he leaped up on the chair and squeezed into the opening. The ventilator was hot. It was agony each time his knees touched the metal. The air was like the blast of a furnace. Ahead, through the blackness, he saw a glimmer of light. Doggedly, he crept on until he was able to pull himself out into the chill night air. Now he had to spread the alarm. He burst into the wing of the bridge and stopped. The fourth officer lay in a widening pool of blood, his young face cut and beaten out of shape. Across the wheel, held upright by the swinging spokes, was the helmsman. A steady, relentless seep of blood dripped from his skull and stained the binnacle face. 18,000 tons of steel and wood were plunging unguided through the night, with tongues of flame licking through the passageways. Bob Clark swung down the ladder to a lower deck. Somewhere, he would have to find an officer. Then he would hunt for the man who had done this. Somewhere in this flaming hull lay $1.5 million worth of dope. There was a connection between it and this fire, Clark felt sure. Yet why should anyone want to destroy his own cargo? Clark jogged into a long passage. A steward was ahead of him. The federal man reached out and grabbed the white jacket.
Listen, the entire bridge is in flames. The captain is dead. Get the chief officer, tell him to get to work. There's no time to lose.
I beg pardon, sir. But have you been drinking?
Clark smashed him flat against the steel bulkhead.
Follow my orders.
Something glittered in his hand. A small gold disc, the badge of the Secret Service.
Quick, we're burning at sea. Understand?
At that moment, three men approached. The first was the man with the sharp face and midnight eyes. The second was Chunky Harrington, the sugar man. The third was Moorcliffe, head of an oil company.
Anything wrong?
Murmured the sharp-faced one at the sight of Clark.
Nothing.
Clark shot a warning glance at the steward. The man with the sharp face smiled.
See here, fellow. My name is George Davis. I'm a stockholder in the West Indies Lines, which owns this ship. I rate the same as the captain here. If anything is actually amiss, I want to know it.
Nothing is wrong, gentlemen. I was just down in the fire room. The chief engineer was showing us the ship and, well, I wanted to show off in front of a young lady, and I had a bit of an accident.
As Clark turned and went forward, he saw over his shoulder that the steward was walking swiftly down the passage toward the salon. Clark swung up toward the boat deck. The radio shack was far aft from the bridge. First of all, he would have to tell the radio man to send an SOS. The faces of Moorcliffe and Harrington and Davis flashed through his mind. All three had been out there on deck. One of them knew what was going on. That, Clark was certain. But the guilty man was an accomplished actor. George Davis's face was sharp and cruel. The man was the type that would stop at nothing to gain financial ends. Of Moorcliffe, Clark knew little. Of Harrington, he had heard more. The man threw extravagant parties in Havana, was a spendthrift and a ladies' man. Clark stopped and looked forward. Smoke was rolling out from the bridge, dark blotches against the black sky. The door of the radio room was open, splashing a panel of light out on the dark deck. Great swirls of smoke were sweeping down upon the place, filling the interior. Sprawled across his set, fingers still clutching the key, lay the radio man. One arm hung down toward the floor, blood dripping from the lax fingers. The back of his skull was smashed flat. Tearing his eyes from the grisly corpse, Clark dived toward another door. Beyond it must be the auxiliary set. The floor was covered with a glass of broken tubes, and the main outfit was useless. Throwing back the door, Clark found the set was hammered to bits. No SOS would go out this night. A great mass of radiograms was spilled on the floor beside the dead operator. Clark scooped them up, ran through them with trembling fingers. Three he selected. One from Moorcliffe to New York, one from Davis to Jersey City, one from Harrington to Havana. His mouth tight and grim, Clark started back toward the salon. In a passageway, he came to an abrupt halt. On the floor, beaten to death, lay the steward he had sent to the first officer. The discovery of the white-jacketed body confirmed Clark's suspicions. He was certain now that Davis, Moorcliffe, or Harrington had known his message or had guessed it. As he strode down the carpeted passage, the odor of smoke became more noticeable. Clark spotted the first officer in the salon waving a cocktail glass at a portly gentleman, Harrington. Oblivious of the eyes which were immediately focused upon him, Clark went straight through the center of the salon to the first mate's table. The officer seemed to sense the nature of the message he was bringing. He set down his glass. Harrington's eyes seemed to pop out of his face. Then another face loomed behind Harrington, the sharp features and black eyes of George Davis. The black eyes were hostile, alive, watchful. Clark beckoned to the first officer and drew him aside.
Holt, you're captain of the ship.
Holt blinked and passed a gold-braided sleeve across his eyes.
What? What do you mean? Is anything...
The captain is dead. Murdered. No one is on the bridge. Your radio is out of working order.
My God.
And you're at fire at sea. Get your crew on the job immediately.
But who?
I'll find that out. Your job is to get us out of this mess as quickly as possible. I sent a steward to you 20 minutes ago, but he was murdered before he reached you.
Clark spun on his heel and went out. Holt might be unnerved for the moment, but he would know what to do. Suddenly, a small card in the brass holder on a cabin door caught Clark's eye. A card which read George Davis. Clark glanced back to make certain the corridor was empty. He tried the door. It was unlocked, and he stepped into the cabin. Grips were stacked against the wall, and beside them lay a briefcase, its contents spilling out onto the rug. Clark knelt beside the case and ran quick fingers through the papers. He found several radiograms, but they all dealt with market matters. Then he discovered a series of penciled notations. He was about to pass them by when he saw one figure of $1.5 million. Another figure had been subtracted from it, leaving something less than $500,000. $1.5 million was the value of the dope which had been traced to the dock from which the Cubana had sailed. Clark thrust the paper into his breast pocket and glanced about for other clues. The knob of the door rattled. Clark jerked to his feet and sprang behind the door, palming his gun. The door swung back. From behind it, Clark could not see the intruder. There was no other sound. Evidently, the person who had entered was standing on the threshold, studying the room. Abruptly, the door slammed shut, and Clark was again alone. Quickly, he jerked the knob toward him and jumped out into the passageway. A back was retreating around a bend of the corridor. Clark plunged after it. The man ahead was Harrington. Clark snapped out and caught at the man's shoulders, spinning him around. Harrington's face was lined, his eyes wide and fearful.
What? What's the matter?
What were you doing in Davis's room?
My wife. I can't find her. I thought she might... I left her in the cabin 20 minutes ago, and now she's gone.
Clark studied his features and then released the shoulder.
I haven't seen your wife, and I wouldn't know her if I did see her. What were you doing on the forecastle head a half hour ago?
Oh, Me? Why, I went up there with Davis. He said I'd been drinking too much, needed air. Wanted me to... What are you looking at me that way for, man?
Did Davis take you there? Was he the one who suggested it?
Certainly. What's going on? What's wrong with going up there for a minute to get some air? Listen, I've got to find my wife.
Now go ahead.
Then he walked back toward the salon. Deep in thought, Clark did not at first notice the girl who darted out of a cabin ahead of him. She was tall and lovely, well poised, dressed in a flowing evening gown. She glanced back, and her eyes mirrored terror. With two quick strides, he caught up with her.
Pardon me, but perhaps I could be of help?
Help? Perhaps a moment ago, but not now. We're burning.
Her face was blank, as though she talked in a nightmare.
I saw smoke, and he's done it.
Who's done it?
Then she seemed to snap back to reality. She turned as though she wanted to get away, but Clark's gaze held her.
I don't know who he is. He warned me not to take this boat. He said...
Who are you? You're referring to the man who shipped $1.5 million worth of dope on this boat? You're afraid of him for some reason.
She gasped and looked at him wide-eyed.
I know nothing about that. I don't want...
Don't want him to get arrested?
No.
That did?
No,
that
no.
It?
I mean... I don't know what I mean. You're a detective. You're ready to pin anything on anybody at the slightest excuse. You won't get her, but I don't care what happens to him. He's rotten all the way through.
Who is?
I don't know his name. He's a fiend, a devil. He's made her life a living hell. I only saw him once, and then he wore a mask. His eyes were black and cruel. They bore straight through you. He's aboard the ship. She told me that he was.
And who is she?
Madame Seville, of course.
Clark suppressed his astonishment. Now the ends were beginning to tie together.
Then Madame Seville is aboard. I've been trying to find her.
You won't. She'll be dead, if she isn't already. I've been searching for an hour, but she's vanished. She was supposed to meet me tonight to tell me about him, but she didn't come. But if anything happens to me, there's two men that you must watch. One is Moorcliffe, the other is Davis.
All right, but who are you?
I'm Harrington's secretary, Jean Raymond.
Leaving the girl in her room, Bob Clark started up to the boat deck. The smoke which hit him there was blinding, suffocating. He peered forward. Men were up there, scurrying back and forth in the light of the flames, carrying hoses and chemical extinguishers. By this time, news of the catastrophe was seeping through the cabins. Men and women stood about in huddled little groups, their eyes round with fear, watching the flames. Moorcliffe was standing there looking forward, a faint smile on his face. His dark eyes swept restlessly, triumphantly over the scene. Before Clark could approach, an elderly lady snatched at the detective's arm.
Hadn't we better take to the boats?
No. It'll be all right in a few minutes, I'm sure. They'll have it all under control.
But my son says that it's below deck, too.
Clark left her abruptly. If this were true, it was quite possible that the entire hold would go up in flames. Clark hurried down and went forward to the deck just under the bridge. He found the shaft. One glance was enough. Far below, he could see fire licking. Small coils of smoke were coming up from the cracks. The hold was on fire. Clark knew in that instant the ship was doomed. There would be no saving it now. The best they could hope to do would be to send up rocket signals and take to the boats before the deck was consumed. With that in mind, a small glass case caught his eye. rockets. With one kick, he broke the glass and jerked down an armload. Stumbling through the haze, he lunged to the rail and threw down his burden. Taking a box of matches from his pocket, he propped a rocket against the rail. He struck a match. Suddenly, a hand lashed out and knocked the blaze from his grasp. Davis stood there, unperturbed, shaking his head in the negative, a gun in his hand.
"Don't you think that that is the duty of an officer?"
he said softly, his hawk face twitching.
"And get an officer down here."
His muscles tightened. He measured the distance between them.
"Why don't you want me to send out a warning?"
"There are reasons. I'm afraid that I will find it necessary to lock you in your room."
"Oh, you tried that once."
"What do you mean?"
Clark started to shrug, but the movement was deceptive. Suddenly, his hands jabbed at the gun. It went off far to the right. Then his fist smashed into Davis's face. Davis screamed. His black eyes wild with hate. Dropping the gun, he closed in like a madman. Clark stepped aside and snapped another blow to the jaw. Davis wavered, then seemed to go mad, shouting wildly. He clawed at Clark's face with talon-like fingers. Viciously, he jabbed his knee up toward Clark's groin, but the detective stepped aside. A left shot home to the point of the jaw was followed by a stunning right. Davis tottered and then slumped inert to the planking. Clark sprang back to the rockets. He lit another match and held the wavering flame to the fuse. With a sizzling rush, the rocket stabbed up into the night, trailing an arc of fire behind it. A second followed, reached halfway to the zenith before the first exploded with a loud report. The third was the end of the series. At two-minute intervals, Clark sent off the others. Then Clark dragged the still unconscious Davis into the salon. Many passengers were there, talking excitedly, their voices husky with fear. Clark found a steward and ordered him to guard Davis. Clark hurried up to the boat deck. The heat there was terrific. Through the choking smoke, Clark made his way to a lifeboat to make certain that the boat was in good working order. Everything seemed all right, but something still troubled him. He turned and grasped the davit, the crane-like arm which was supposed to swing the boat out over the side so that it could be launched. The davit did not move. Clark kneeled beside its base. The joint had been welded tight. The davit could not be moved. Despite the heat, which seared his cheeks, Bob Clark stood staring blankly, completely baffled by the puzzle which confronted him. The man who had done this thing would lose $1.5 million through it. The dope would be consumed with the ship, a total loss. At the same time, he had trapped himself utterly by rendering these lifeboats useless. Was he a senseless fool? Clark did not think so. There was something else in back of this. Harrington, face lit up with anxiety, came reeling through the smoke and jostled against Clark.
"Have you found my wife?"
"I wasn't looking for your wife. Have you been in the reading rooms and the salons?"
"All of them. All of them. She's gone, and we're sinking. We'll die, all of us. Like rats! Why don't they take to the boats? Why don't these officers do something?"
"Quiet. You'll start a panic."
"Panic? Panic? What do I care for that? She's gone, and they're letting us die!"
Harrington's bloated features quivered with grief. He staggered away, lurching drunkenly, blinded by smoke and tears. Clark started forward to find Holt. The chief mate was black and disheveled, sweating with a hose line.
"The pumps are petering out on us. There isn't any steam in the lines. That damned engineer..."
"You'll have steam."
He whirled and started down the companionway toward amidships, intending to head for the engine room. But the sight of Moorcliffe stopped him. Moorcliffe was standing in the background watching the losing fight against the flames. Clark heard the man laugh. He grabbed Moorcliffe by the shoulder and spun him about.
You've been getting a big kick out of this, haven't you? What's so funny about it?
Why, you see, I have some tankers in the West Indies lines and...
Moorcliffe fell silent and sagged back, and then suddenly his fist swept up in a vicious arc. But Clark had been watching for just that move. He jabbed a fast right into the oil man's throat and sent him back gasping, screaming.
Ah, damn you! I'll get you, you lousy dick!
He pawed at his thigh, fumbling for a gun. Clark kicked the weapon away. Moorcliffe went limp and Clark left him where he lay. Still boiling, Clark swung into the passageway on B deck and headed toward the stern. He went into the salon and found the place deserted. George Davis was nowhere in evidence, nor was the steward with whom Clark had left him. What did that mean? Clark determined to find out. A light footfall in back of him caused him to whirl around. The girl, Jean Raymond, was hurrying toward him. Anxiety was written on her beautiful features. Her dress was in tatters.
I can't find her, but I found something else. I've been looking everywhere for you.
You mean you can't find Madame Seville?
No, but I found this.
She extended a slip of paper, the shipper's copy of a bill of lading.
I thought it might be a code message or something.
Where did this come from?
It was lying under George Davis's door when I went in there the second time.
Clark stared at it. It was an ordinary bill of lading, not at all remarkable, save for the cubic footage it covered. This, however, immediately aroused Clark's interest. He calculated that $1.5 million worth of heroin would occupy just about that space. The bill was marked...
Island product samples.
The notation showed that the goods were to be stowed in hold number 4, all the way aft. Sending the girl forward, Clark swung down a ladder which was marked engine room. He came to a huge double door of steel and swung it open. Below him lay the ship's engines. He swung down 3 stages and looked forward. Far below, on the engine room floor, he spied a huddled form. Otherwise, the place was deserted. That was why they were getting no steam on the upper deck. Then Clark saw the flames. Though there was nothing there to burn, the fire was sweeping on down the steel floor. The oil tanks. They had been pierced and then set afire. Undecided for an instant, Clark hovered on the ladder. If he went aft to trace that dope, he might be trapped. Then he reached a decision. He was going down. The blaze leaped out at him like a hungry beast. He snatched at a rail and slid to the next stage. Under his feet, the steel plates were like the top of a stove. Running swiftly around the mighty engines, he made his way to a double door and dashed through to the sparsely filled number 4. The lights were still burning, running on emergency batteries. He could see the piles of boxes. Without difficulty, he found the boxes marked Island Product Samples. They were quite innocent in appearance, extremely light. Clark smashed the first down against the plates. Then he took a second, a third, a fourth. Every box was empty. He had found no dope. The lead which had brought him to the Cubana was evidently false, but it had looked so certain. Face set. He plunged again for the open air to burst out onto a deck where all hell had broken loose. The panic-stricken passengers were tearing at each other, fighting to get at the boats, leaping overboard. The fire had consumed the deckhouses now. It was reaching down into the cabins. Flames sprouted everywhere. The terrific heat became unbearable. Bitterly, Clark cursed the man responsible for this horror. Grimly, he swore to apprehend the fiend somehow. Moorcliffe was staggering aft, fighting dully to get down the companionway. Harrington was pleading with a third officer to find his wife. Davis was nowhere to be seen. And then Clark heard a new sound, the sputter of an engine. He ran to the rail. Dimly seen by the red glow of the fire, a launch lay hard in under the Cubana's bows. Clark watched it with hard eyes. Some of the mystery was explained by the presence of the boat. It was a sea-going craft, very fast and had undoubtedly come out straight from the shore. But its furtiveness showed that it had not come in response to the signal rockets. A dim shadow appeared at the ship's rail above the launch. The light blinked twice in rapid succession. From the cockpit of the boat came an answering blink. Clark's 38 stabbed out redly before him. The light in the boat went out. Above the bedlam of shouts around him, Clark heard a scream. Ah! The shadow at the rail faltered. A red tongue of flame suddenly illuminated the man's face. It was Matt. Clark fired again, and the shadow disappeared. Clark grabbed a life preserver rope, tied one end to the rail, and went over the side in a clean dive. When he reached the rope's end, the jerk almost pulled his arms from their sockets, but he swung toward the bobbing boat.
Who's that?
Snarled a voice in the cockpit.
Some crazy loon! Shoot him!
Another directed, but Clark shot first. The second man to speak clutched at his chest and tumbled over the side. The first jerked out a gun and fired straight at the face above the rail. Again, the 38 won. His face stinging from the burned powder, Clark climbed up over the side. The launch was more than 75 feet in length, powered by heavy, throbbing diesels. Clark went straight to the wheelhouse. A head thrust itself out.
Who's that? The boss?
A heavy voice demanded. Before Clark could answer, a flashlight outlined him. Clark shot just over the top of it. There was a grunt. He fired again. The flashlight rolled down the sloping planks and splashed into the sea. Warily, the federal man entered the wheelhouse. The thing he wanted was on the charting table, a radio. Although the set was small, it would be sufficient. He sat down before the key and pounded out the first news that the outside world was to hear of the Cubana disaster.
SOS. 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 Calling all ships on the high seas. SS Cubana, in flames about 50 miles off the coast of New Jersey. No lifeboats. Pumps failed. All ships rush aid immediately.
Then Clark shut off the set and went out on deck. With cupped hands, he bawled for Holt.
Send down an officer and crew for this launch,
he shouted when the chief mate appeared at the rail.
I've sent an SOS. You can use this to pick the people out of the water.
They threw him a line and he wrapped it around an iron bit. Every nerve in his body urged him to stay there next to the cool water. But he had to go back up into that hell to get the man who was responsible for it. Hand over hand, Clark went up the rope. In a moment, the deck was scorching his feet. That deck was an inferno of terrified people. Through the milling mass, Clark saw Harrington. The man's face was drawn with agony.
We're lost! We'll all die!
Help is on the way. Buck up. Did you find your wife?
Harrington stared at him with unseeing eyes and shook his head vaguely as Clark strode away. Clark located a steward and grabbed the fellow by his white jacket.
What was the number of Harrington's room?
Suite V6.
The white-clad figure gasped. Clark took off his wet coat and wrapped it about his face. As he stared forward, the fire lashed at him, driving him back. He buried his face deeper in the coat and plunged ahead. V6 was a raging furnace. The woodwork had been consumed and the terrific heat had all but melted the metal. Clark plunged inside, gritting his teeth. He groped about on the floor until his fingers encountered something soft and yielding. Dragging at it, he retreated swiftly, the passageway collapsing behind him as he went. Shouldering his burden, he staggered up the companionway. Clark threw down the charred body and, shielding his face against the wall of flame which came from the bridge, looked about for Harrington. It was several minutes before he found the man. Harrington seemed devoid of all intelligence. He had given up.
Is that your wife?
Clark pointed down at the body. The face was black, the flesh charred. There was little left for identification except a necklace of gold. Harrington fumbled with the locket. Then he stared up at Clark, his eyes unseeing.
Yes.
And then he collapsed over the body. Clark dragged him away and told him to stay there. Then Clark made his way aft. He had not seen Moorcliffe, nor had he seen Davis. He meant to find them, especially Davis. The heat was beyond human endurance. Close to the bridge, the air would sear the lungs, would kill instantly. Try as he would, Clark could not get within 50 feet of the passageways. It was 2 o'clock in the morning before the first rescue ship loomed up out of the haze beside the Cubana. Clark went to the rail and stared at the newcomer with seared eyes. The second mate beside him asked wearily,
"What's at the bottom of all this? I don't know who you are, but you seem to be in the know."
"Not yet, I'm not. Do you know Moorcliffe when you see him?"
"Sure, but I haven't seen him for an hour. He's a big shot in the old game up north. Runs a line out of Venezuela. Tankers. He lost one of his contracts, and he had to lay off a lot of his boats. He's pretty sore about it. I wonder why he took this ship."
"How about George Davis?"
"Haven't seen him for a while either. He's kind of nutty. He's on the board of this line. This loss will cost him plenty."
"What about insurance?"
"Oh, there may be plenty of that."
The officer peered intently at the detective.
"Say, you don't think they tried to burn us for the insurance, do you? The line has been running in the hole for 3 years now. Al..."
He gripped the rail to steady himself. Clark caught him and kept him from falling. The wall of heat was like a savage advancing army. All the cabins were going now. The sea glowed as red as blood all about the blazing pyre. Moorcliffe staggered up, stumbling, his face drawn with fear and exhaustion. Clark eased him to the deck and kneeled beside him. Then, certain that Moorcliffe would live, the Federal man crawled aft, closer to the flames. His red-rimmed eyes peered everywhere for Davis. Lying in the protection of a bit, Clark found him, gasping for breath, his blade-like face swollen and blistered. Davis looked up with dull eyes. There was something unnatural about the man's attitude. His back looked stiff, as though braced against pain.
"A knife. He got me. With a knife. He..."
The man had fainted. Clark rolled him over. The hilt of a weapon protruded from between his shoulder blades. Clark pulled it out. Thrusting a handful of kapok taken from a torn life belt over the wound, he bound it as well as he could. Then, suddenly, he felt his head swimming, and the deck was hot against his cheek. He could no longer find the strength to hold up his head. He realized that he had been running on sheer nerve for hours, and now that nerve was gone. Twice he tried to stagger to the rail where the rescue liner's boats were dragging people from the water, but it was no use. He was too tired to go on, too tired to fight.
"Cubana, ahoy!"
A loud, bellowing voice rolled out across the water.
"Coast Guard cutter 337, stand by with lines. We'll take you off."
Robert W. Clark of the U.S. Secret Service sat up. It was as though he had had a bucket of ice water thrown over his scorched body. The Coast Guard, his own outfit. It was coming right in alongside the Cubana. Person after person went over to the cutter to be treated for burns and exposure out of the red hell to the cool decks of the gray ship. Now other vessels were arriving and the sea was laced with crisscrossing searchlights. But not until dawn did Bob Clark allow himself to stagger into the cutter's sickbay for treatment, hot coffee, and better than either, sleep. Hours later, Bob Clark was finishing his story of the disaster. Only a few officials were there, and a few of the passengers of the doomed Cubana. Davis, Moorcliffe, and Harrington sat against the far wall under guard. Jean Raymond looked across the green-covered table at Bob Clark.
"Now, to finish up, I promised to tell you who the firebug is, and why he did it. I know now that none of all of this was without reason. The man was driven by fear and greed."
He spread out the three radiograms he had taken from the radio room, the ace of spades, the gold locket, the bill of lading.
"These will give us the entire story. I thought for a while that all of this was caused by Davis, but it was not. Actually, Davis is a dupe. Head of the most powerful drug ring in New York. He ordered $1.5 million worth of dope from Havana. He paid $1 million in advance, leaving the other $500,000 to be paid on delivery. I found the notation of these amounts in Davis's briefcase. This bill of lading was discovered on Davis's stateroom floor. You will notice that Davis is a consignee.
Heads nodded. All eyes were fastened on Clark.
Davis, as a director of this company, was able to import dope without inspection. He made good use of the fact that no one would ever suspect him.
Clark glanced at Davis's contorted face.
He thought that this dope was contained in these boxes, but he had nothing to do with the fire. I thought he had when he interfered with me sending rockets. I know now that as an officer of the line, he did not want another ship to salvage on the Cubana before it was absolutely necessary. He did not know how bad the fire actually was. As for Moorcliffe, he was glad about the fire until it threatened his own life. He was sore because the West Indies line took business away from him. Therefore, Harrington is the firebug, the murderer.
Harrington lurched out of the chair. An automatic pushed him back.
Harrington received the dope order from Davis. Harrington handles dope from South America and relays it to the United States. Harrington is greedy and a coward. He received that $1 million with which he was supposed to purchase heroin and opium. He spent it and could not replace it, and he had no dope. He was afraid of Davis. Terribly afraid of what Davis would do to him if the dope was not actually aboard. Unknown to Davis, these boxes were empty, and there was no dope aboard the Cubana. Now get this. Harrington had to cover up that fact before Davis discovered it. Therefore, the Cubana had to be destroyed. So Harrington arranged to have a launch trail the liner. He thought he would be able to get away on it. But I happened along on time to spike that plan. Harrington wanted the Cubana to sink or burn. Fire was easier to handle. So he set fire to the liner by means of an acetylene torch connected with the bell hammer of the captain's clock. At 8 bells, the clock opened the valve of the acetylene tank and the fire began. Harrington had an alibi. He made certain that Davis and Moorcliffe were with him at 8 bells. Then, so that no word could be sent out, Harrington murdered the radio operator and smashed the set, so that the ship would go off her course and lose her position, making her hard to locate. He killed the bridge officer and the helmsman to make certain that no witnesses against him could escape. He had welded the bottom of the lifeboat davits so that none of the boats could be launched. Harrington knew a narcotics man was aboard. He had made certain that this fake dope cargo was traced in Havana. He wanted Davis to be sure that the dope was aboard and that he, Harrington, had not swindled Davis. Afraid that the narcotics man would gum his plans, he tortured the captain into revealing my name. Then he tried several times to kill me. When Harrington knew that he was slipping up, he started howling about his wife. There was a corpse in his cabin, but it was not his wife's. This locket from the dead woman's neck says to Madame Seville for past services and future loyalty. Madame Seville was an aide of Harrington's, but he knew she was double-crossing him. This ace of spades was written on by the dying captain, naming Madame Seville as the dope runner. Jean Raymond and Madame Seville worked together. Jean Raymond was not certain that Harrington was the head of the Havana ring, but she had her ideas. Madame Seville was going to make the revelation last night, but she died before she got the chance. Harrington was ironbound in his alibis. He couldn't have started the fire, but he did. He wouldn't destroy $1.5 million in dope, and so he knew that would never be suspected by those who knew of his dope activities. And he wouldn't kill his wife. But Harrington's wife was in Havana. He sent her this radiogram on the night before the fire. I found it, and that tripped up Harrington. As for other angles of the case, I gave Davis into the hands of the steward, who immediately released him because Davis was a company director. Davis was stabbed by Harrington just before we were rescued, because Harrington was afraid Davis would get wise, but he failed that time. And finally, I want to get an invitation to Harrington's execution. I'm not bloodthirsty, but he ought to be burned 1,000 times for that flaming hell he kindled for innocent people.
Then Clark pulled a piece of paper toward him and scribbled out his report to his chief in Washington.
There was no dope on the Cubana.
Signed, Robert W. Clark.